So as we've saw in the last video, we're going to have three types of motion for these damped harmonic oscillators: underdamped, critically damped, and overdamped. So let's look at the solutions we get for each of these three cases, and the type of case that we get depends on this quantity called the damping ratio. So the problem we have here is this square root. Now, the first case we're going to consider, because we've got three cases to worry about, is the case where zeta is greater than 1. Now, when zeta is greater than 1, we've got the square root of a positive number, and so everything's fine. But as you can see, we're going to have other cases where zeta is not greater than 1, and that is going to lead us into some trouble. But first case is when zeta is greater than 1. So this is going to give us a real number here. Now, the other thing to notice is that square root of zeta squared minus 1 is going to be always less than zeta. So zeta here is always going to be greater than the square root of zeta squared minus 1, because you're taking zeta squared, you're subtracting 1 from it, and then you're taking the square root. So this is always going to be true. And what that means is that both q plus and minus, it doesn't matter, are both going to be less than 0. And this is actually going to turn out to be a good thing, because as we can see here, they're in the exponents. And so if we had a positive exponent, that would mean that the displacement would exponentially grow with time, and that would be a really bad thing to happen, because we'd then get infinite displacements, and clearly that would, you know, violate conservation of energy and lots of other nasty things. However, because q, either the plus or the minus, is always going to be less than 0, because we have this minus zeta times omega naught here, and then we're either adding or subtracting this term, which is always smaller than it, because we always have a negative value, these are going to be a displacement which exponentially decays away. And so what we're going to have is we're going to have x of t here is going to be equal to, and I'm actually going to take a factor out here, this is going to be e to the minus omega naught times zeta multiplied by a, and then e to the, and now we've got omega naught t times the square root of zeta squared minus 1, and then plus b e to the minus omega naught t times the square root of zeta squared minus 1. And so this is the sum of two negative exponentials, and so we can plot this for some example values of omega naught and zeta. And so here is what we get. We call this type of damping overdamping, and so this is the case when the damping ratio zeta is greater than 1, we get this class of motion called overdamping. And as you can see, if you look at the plot here for some example values of omega naught, zeta, a, and b, we end up with an exponentially decaying curve. Now, there is a little bit of a kink of it if you look at it here. That's where you switch over from 1, the very steeply falling exponential, to the more slowly falling exponential. And where that little sort of kink occurs is going to depend on your exact values of zeta and omega naught. But as you can see, there are no oscillations. It's just an exponential decay of the mass back to the equilibrium position. And that's the type of motion we call overdamping. So here we are back at our solution, and we've got our two values for q. But now we're going to look at the case where zeta is equal to 1. Now, when we put zeta equal to 1, this square root goes to 0. And instead of having two solutions, suddenly our solution has collapsed, and it's just collapsed to a, e, and now q is just omega naught, because omega zeta here is equal to 1. So this is now minus omega naught times t. So that suggests we've got an exponential decay, but we have a problem. Remember that our equation of motion looks like this. So it's 2 omega naught times x dot, I'm putting zeta equal to 1 here, plus omega naught squared x equals 0. Now, this is a second order differential equation. We've got an x double dot term here, but we only have one constant of integration, A. And if you remember, way back at the start when we looked at simple harmonic oscillators, we said we can't do that. We've integrated twice. We must have a second constant of integration. And in that case, what was happening is we were missing the constant phase. So we could add an extra expression in there. We could add an extra constant term in there. We hadn't got a complete solution. And that's the same thing here. We're missing an extra term. Now, the way we find that is if we look at this, we've got a certain sort of binomial symmetry to this second order differential equation. We've got x double dot here, and then we've got 2 omega naught, which is the differential of this omega naught term, and then we've got an x dot, and then we've got an x. And it turns out when you have this sort of pattern in a second order differential equation, the solution that you're missing is x of t is equal to b times t times e to the minus omega naught times t. So you can test this, you know, we can differentiate this and put it into this equation, and what you'll find is that in the case where zeta is equal to 1, you end up with this perfect symmetry in this differential equation, and it allows the terms that you get when you're doing this, differentiating this by the chain rule, it allows these terms to cancel out perfectly, and so this solution works in this very special case. And so our full solution becomes e to the minus omega naught times t multiplied by a plus bt. And so we've got our two constants of integration, a and b, and this is now the solution in the case where zeta is equal to 1. Now, as you can see, we're going to end up with this exponential decay, but we've got this additional t term here. And the result of this is in this particular case, we get an exponential decay plot. We'll look at that in a minute. But we get x going to 0 in the fastest possible time. So x going to 0 and remaining at 0. So in other words, the object will return to the equilibrium position in the fastest possible time in this case, and we call this type of damping critical damping. And so let's have a look at the plot of the displacement versus time. And so this is the plot for critical damping for particular values of omega naught A and B. And so remember that in this case, zeta is equal to 1. And what you can see is you can see this exponential decay back to the origin. However, because of this extra t function, you can see that it sort of actually goes level as you go towards time t equals 0. So this gives you the fastest return to the equilibrium position where the mass will actually remain in the equilibrium position. So here we are back at our solution for the damped harmonic oscillator, and now we're going to look at the case where the damping ratio is less than 1. And as you can see, this is going to cause a problem because now this brackets, the value inside the square root term here, is going to give us a negative number. So we've got the square root of a negative number. Now, if you remember, this happened before, right at the start when we were talking about the simple harmonic oscillator, and we ended up with something squared that had to be equal to minus 1. And we defined, we said that we're going to define this term here where I squared is equal to minus 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to use this and we're going to rewrite this expression. It's going to be omega naught times zeta, that doesn't change, plus or minus, and then omega naught here. And then it's going to be the square root of I squared times, well, I squared is minus 1, so this is now 1 minus zeta squared. And so this becomes minus omega naught zeta plus or minus I omega naught times the square root of 1 minus zeta squared. And now this is the square root of a positive number, so we're all happy. The only thing is we have this strange imaginary number out here. Now, when we put this into our solution, this is again, this is exactly the sort of thing we did right at the start with the simple harmonic oscillator. We had x of t, and we're going to have x of t, and that's going to be equal to, well, we've got this constant, well, not constant, but you've got this same term in both of these expressions, e to the minus omega naught zeta t. So I'm going to take that out. So e to the minus omega naught zeta t, and then what's left is going to be a, and then it's e
to the I omega naught square root of 1 minus zeta squared times t plus b e to the minus I omega naught square root of 1 minus zeta squared times t. Now, this thing here we've seen before. If you remember way back at the start when we looked at the simple harmonic oscillator, we came up with this expression for e to the I omega t and e to the minus I omega t, and we said, well, we can't do anything with this because we've got to have a real displacement, and so we've got to go back and we've got to find a real solution to this, even though this was the sort of the most general mathematical solution. Well, we've got the same thing here. We've got the same expression, only now, instead of omega, we've got omega naught times the square root of 1 minus zeta squared. But it's the same function other than that. And so, as we had with the simple harmonic oscillator, when we got rid of the imaginary parts, all that we had left here was a cosine term with a phase. And this is exactly what is going to happen here. This is going to, if we look at the real part of this, and we only want the real part because that's the only thing we're interested in with physics. So we want to constrain these values of a and b so that we get a real function. And when we do that, we're going to end up with a, where this is now a real number a, times the cosine. And then instead of omega t, because remember this was omega, is replaced now by omega naught square root of 1 minus zeta squared. So we're going to have omega naught square root of 1 minus zeta squared times t plus a constant phase phi. And so this is what we get when we look at the real, when we constrain this solution to be real so that we get a real number that measures the real displacement of the mass. And so our solution in this case now is equal to a e to the minus omega naught zeta times t times the cosine of omega naught square root of 1 minus zeta squared t plus a constant phi. So we've got our two constants, phi and a, and we have a cosine term. So what we're going to have here is we're going to have oscillations because of the cosine term. But unlike for a simple harmonic oscillator where we just have this constant a out of the front that gives us the amplitude, here we have this exponential decay term. So we've got e to the minus time. So what we're going to have is we're going to have oscillations with an exponentially decaying amplitude. So let's have a look and see what that looks like. So this is our solution here. What we've done is we've actually set a equal to 1. And so if you remember, we have this exponentially decaying amplitude. And so this gives us this envelope. So this is the exponentially decaying amplitude here. And we can see that we have this cosine term that is oscillating inside this envelope. So we've got a cosine term multiplied by a negative exponential. And so we get oscillations which gradually go away and damp to zero. And so for a real oscillator that you actually, a system that you actually see oscillating in real life, this is always what you see. There's always some small lossy force that causes it to damp away and go to zero. And so this is actually what you see, an exponentially decaying amplitude. So this is the case for zeta being less than 1, so the damping ratio less than 1, and we call this underdamping. So this type of motion is called underdamping.
So what we've got here is an example of a damped harmonic oscillator. So I've got the mass on the end of a spring, which is our harmonic oscillator, but now I put the mass in water, and that is going to generate a damping force like the ones we've discussed. And so what we would expect, since this is going to be an underdamped system where the damping is not particularly large, what we would get is oscillations that will decrease in amplitude over time. So I'll set the system vibrating. And so the fact that it's vibrating tells you that it's an underdamped system, but as you can see, the oscillations are decreasing in size. So I can do that again. And you can see that over time, we're oscillating, we're going up and down, but the amplitude of the oscillations is exponentially decaying due to the damping force, and in fact now it's just about stopped. So that's an underdamped harmonic oscillator. Okay, so what we have now is we've got the same setup we had before, but I've replaced the water with glycerin, and this has a far higher viscosity, and so it's going to generate a lot more damping in the system. And so if I try to set the mass oscillating now, nothing happens. It returns back to its equilibrium position, but it does not oscillate. Right? No matter how many times I try to get it vibrating up and down, it's not going to vibrate. It's simply too much damping in the system. And so this is an example of an overdamped system. There's no oscillations. All that happens if you displace the mass from equilibrium is it returns back to the equilibrium position with this characteristic two exponential graph plot that we discussed earlier. So now we've seen how a damped harmonic oscillator moves depending on the value of the damping ratio. We have these three types of motion. We have the underdamped motion, where we have an oscillator whose amplitude is exponentially decaying. We have the overdamped, where we just have an exponential decay. And then we have this one that sits in between the two, the critically damped. And what's interesting with the critically damped motion is that's the one that returns the object back to the equilibrium position in the fastest possible time, which has implications when you're designing things like earthquake dampeners and or shock absorbers for cars, where you want to damp an oscillation as rapidly as possible. So those are the three different types of motion that we get with a damped harmonic oscillator.